Dr. Bob made a statement that sounded along the lines of, we must wean these people off of our dependence and upon a dependence of God, a power greater than themselves, as quick as possible. That it is unhealthy for any human being to be dependent on another human being. And when I came across a guy some years ago who explained exactly what to do in these situations, when what you have is you have a person who has asked you for help through the 12 steps, and we're reading the chapter, working with others. This isn't calculus. It ain't algebra. This is real simple stuff. So this person calls me on the phone, an example, and says, I have a problem with my wife. She's leaving. She's taking the kids and the business and the house, and they're kicking me out. What should I do? And normally, your answer might be, well, this is what you ought to do. You run, get you a lawyer and blah, blah, and do this. How can she do that, this F and B and all that, blah, 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 blah. Wrong. Wrong. The answer is, take them straight to the steps with this. Is there something about this situation in your life that has you afraid? Is there something about this situation in your life that has you angry? Something that makes you feel guilty? Maybe you fell short of where you're supposed to be, so you feel guilty for not being there, and now she's turned away from you. And so it is the job of a sponsor to turn the sponsee to the 12 steps and to a God of their understanding, not to answer any questions like, I'll tell you what you ought to do with that, you know, problem in your life. You just sit back and listen to me. I'll give you all the answers. Wrong answer for both people. And that's the idea there. The minute we put our work on a service plane, the alcoholic commences to rely upon our assistance rather than upon God. He clamors for this or that, claiming he cannot master alcohol until his material needs are cured, are cared for. Nonsense. Some of us have taken very hard knocks to learn this truth. Job or no job, wife or no wife, we simply do not stop drinking so long as we place dependence upon other people ahead of dependence on God. Burn the idea into the consciousness of every man that he can get well regardless of anyone. The only condition is that he trust in God and clean house. Now, the domestic problem. There may be divorce, separation, or just strained relations. When your prospect has made such reparation as he can to his family and has thoroughly explained to them the new principles by which he is living, he should proceed to put those principles into action at home. Now, let's stop for a minute. You know, that's pretty vague right there. He's not giving us, but when we go back into the pages in which we have been from, you know, pages which we've already read, which principles is it that he's talking about here? He says, when your prospect has made such reparation, that's obviously step 9, as he can to his family, and has thoroughly explained to them the new principles by which he is living, he should proceed to put those principles into action at home. And those principles are forgiveness when you are angry, faith in God when you are afraid, and making amends when you've harmed others. That is the spiritual solutions in Alcoholics Anonymous, along with step 5 of admission. Admission is, you know, it's a spiritual solution, but it's also clearly seen. So too is amends, I guess, when you look at amends, but most people don't see forgiveness in there. They seem to zoom right by forgiveness. And faith in God, most people don't see that as being step 12. Admission is step 5, obviously. Forgiveness is in 6 and 7. And making amends is in 8 and 9. And faith in God is step 12. Step 12 is how we have faith in God in Alcoholics Anonymous. It's why we say faith without works is dead, the works being you bring another alcoholic through the 12 steps to a God of their understanding. And for the lack, you know, one of the best descriptions, let me take it, and then I'll finish this up real quick, and we'll pick up right there. And where did I leave off? Principles into action at home. So I'll stop right there for a sec. And we'll go out to, let me show you something, something that I stumbled across some years ago. And it's essentially saying that all this work we do in AA is all secondary. It all becomes a secondary motive to, let me show you, this is also out in a vision for you. And I always say to my sponsees, who is this a vision for anyway? Is this a vision for the next guy coming in the meeting? Is this a vision for the people who've gone before you? No, this is a vision for you. This is on page This is on page 159, and it's about the second full paragraph from the top on 159. And I'll give you a brief explanation of what we're reading here. This whole chapter is essentially, well, most of, about 90% of this chapter is Bill Wilson, a New York stockbroker, has been sober for 6 months, and he is on the edge of a drink. His 6 months are over. There's no AA. There's no Oxford groups. Everything that's over the last 70-something years does not exist because Bill is standing out the door outside of a bar, and he is going to drink that night. You understand that? His sobriety is over. But something happens. His sanity returns. He finds a phone booth. There's a number in there. He calls this number and ends up through a series of other people coming across the Oxford groupers and Dr. Bob. And Dr. Bob gets sober while he's in this foreign city, Akron, Ohio. And this is a vision for you from the standpoint that you are on the edge of a drink. Your sobriety is over. You are going to lose your sobriety, and you're going to drink that night. It's all you're going to pick up a white chip, and maybe 5 years of drinking it starts that night. But when you find another alcoholic to work with, there's something about that, the ego deflation, the humility, the freedom, the getting out of self and doing for others and expecting nothing in return is sobriety. It's the source of our freedom from self, okay? But this is where this story picks up right here. He says, all this time, this is about 10, 12 lines down from the top. All this time, our friend of the hotel lobby incident, that hotel lobby is where that bar is. He's standing outside the door, and he says, I hear the music, and if I could just go in there and steal a little bit of the atmosphere and have a drink or two. He was a friend of the hotel lobby incident, remained in that town in Akron, Ohio for 3 months. Bill Wilson was in Akron, Ohio for 3 months as this fight, this proxy fight that he was there for some kind of Wall Street crap was going on. It was all in the courts or whatever. They were fighting over something, and it didn't turn out good, but it did for Bill because he found Dr. Bob. He was there for 3 months. He now returned home to New York City, leaving behind his first acquaintance, which was Dr. Bob, the lawyer, which is Bill Dobson, and that devil-may-care chap, which is the term he uses in this story for that AA number 4. And he says that these men had found something brand new in life. And though they knew they must help other alcoholics if they would remain sober, that motive became secondary. It was transcended by the happiness they found in giving themselves for others. So everything that we do to work so hard in here in Alcoholics Anonymous and help others through the 12 steps, and all the work that we do in here becomes a secondary motive. And they're saying essentially that if you do good things and become a good person, you are going to feel good about who you are, and essentially how you feel about who you are is going to be, this is a real-world way of describing these spiritual principles. My sponsor was a really religious guy. He used to call the Bible the bigger book. He was always, Jesus this, Jesus that, and I'm like, oh, God, no, you're fucking killing me, man. But he used to always say something that was very powerful, and he'd say, look, the whole program of Alcoholics Anonymous is this simple. If you do good, you're going to feel good on the inside about who you are. And if you do bad, you're going to feel bad on the inside about who you are. And that's all there is to it. And what does an alcoholic do who feels bad on the inside? They drink, okay? And what does an alcoholic do who feels good on the inside? Your sanity returns. You know that even an alcoholic who drinks knows that they can't drink. They say, I can't drink, it's going to kill me. And they look over and there's a drink in their hand. For me, I had no idea where that drink came from. I swore I was never going to take another drink. It was like some kind of blackout, only in sobriety, and I'd wake up into this blackout with a drink in my hand. This, it didn't happen exactly that way, but that's one of the best ways I could use to describe it, because I swore I was never going to take another drink again as long as I lived, and there I was with a beer in my hand. And it essentially boiled down to this selfishness and self-centeredness and the idea that selflessness and self-sacrifice is going to take me out of that. It's going to transcend it was transcended by the happiness they found in giving themselves for others. Anyway, we're going to open up the floor. We got plenty of time. You guys got about 5 minutes each. So anything that we read on, the whole idea of working with others And some of the phrases that we've been going over each week as we're working our way through this chapter were, Bill Wilson says that it is absolutely vital to permanent recovery. That's one of the phrases he uses. Let me see. Absolute necessity is on page 14 in Bill's story, and it is imperative. It is an absolute necessity to work with others, and it is imperative to work with others. That's on page 14 in Bill's story. And in the foreword to the second edition on page Roman numeral 16, it says, it is vital to permanent recovery. Vital to permanent recovery, absolute necessity, imperative. Those are the kind of words used in describing working with another alcoholic. So never question what keeps a person sober for the rest of their lives. This helping others, working with others, is described as, you know, these are pretty profound words that he uses to describe that. Anyway, we'll open up the floor, and anyone who would like to share on step 12, working with others. And, you know, that Bill Wilson had, let's go to Dr. Bob. Dr. Bob had 3 days of sobriety and was sponsoring the AA number 3, Bill Dobson. Dr. Bob had 3 months of sobriety when Bill Wilson went home to Akron, Ohio, or back to New York, and Dr. Bob became the Akron AA. He was it. And he had sponsored some, 5,000 alcoholics at the Akron City Hospital there that they mentioned in Dr. Bob's nightmare, that 5,000 had ministered to 5,000 alcoholics in that hospital. And so, you know, people are saying, well, I've only got 3 months of sobriety. I can't... Anyway, who wants...